The key thing is this. The vital fact to grasp, as I was saying just now, and Paul says it against here, it is only what God makes of us and our motives that really counts. One writer I read this week, another writer, I call Beale, our only motive in doing anything as a Christian should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Any other motive will lead us into sinful behaviour.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Approved by God, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 1 to 12 by Pastor David Wise.
Well, welcome. We're going to be continuing to look at 1 Thessalonians this morning. New series. This may be the first time you've heard this. Is part 2 today. If you missed last time, it's on our website and you can look at the teaching there. I got an email this morning from someone who was a part of the church family until a couple of years ago, gone back to Jamaica, and they were saying they just were watching the teaching on Thessalonians and just how much they were enjoying staying in touch with the teaching. So encourage you to have a look at that. 1 Thessalonians was probably the very first part of the New Testament to be written. The letter was probably written less than 20 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. And the context of this letter was that Paul was writing to encourage the young church. He had to leave Thessalonica very suddenly. He'd been there to preach the gospel, to tell people the good news. And there was a huge opposition to him, and he'd had to leave very suddenly. He'd been unable to return to Thessalonica, so he'd sent Timothy to visit the young church. Timothy came back to Paul, brought him news, and so Paul wrote this letter in response to that news. And the primary driver in him writing was actually to encourage the church. And as I said last time, you know, as we go through here, prepare to be encouraged, because this is good news. Amen. Amen. We all could do with some encouragement, couldn't we? So you already last week had a sort of, when Steve was speaking, a bit of a revision of the week before. But we're going to do it again, because I think it's really important, because, you know, whilst we've got a letter like 1 Thessalonians divided up into chapters and verses, that isn't how Paul wrote it. The first week this came to the Thessalonians, it wasn't that the person leading the church read the first part and said, we'll do the next part next week. They read the whole letter. These letters were designed to be written. And if you've not read it through yet, by the way, I did encourage you to do this a few weeks ago. If you've not read it through, all the way through from start to finish in one sitting, I'd like to encourage you to do that this week. Make yourself a nice mug of tea, cocoa, coffee, whatever it is, you know, fruit tea. Sit down and just read the letter through as though it was a letter you'd received from God just for you. Just read it through. Don't matter if you don't understand all the bits of it, that will all happen as we work through, but just read it through and allow it to get inside. And you might want to do that once a week for the next few weeks. Allow God's word to get inside us. It's not about us sort of dissecting God's word. It's about God's word getting inside us and filling us. So you might want to do it. It might be an exercise for you, homework, for the next month or so. Once a week, make yourself a nice cup of whatever, sit down and just read it. It's very short. Only take you a matter of a few minutes, depending on how fast you read. But just to read it through and just allow God's word to get inside you. So let's think back to the first chapter we looked at last time. What were the main things that we learnt last time? What were the key things from last time that we picked up? Whether you were here, whether you watched it on the internet subsequently, what were the key things from last time? What do you remember? Wayne.
We are loved and chosen by God.
Amen. Oh, say that again.
We are loved and chosen by
God. We're loved and chosen by God. Yes, fantastic. What else?
The church is gathering the people for the purpose of the Father.
Yes, churches, people gather. Remember, we looked at that word church and the first occurrence, the first time the word church, how it people gathered together for God the Father. And we got excited. Well, I got excited about that, and you caught some of the excitement as well. What else? What were the other key things from last time? I'll come back to you. You've had one go. What else? Key things from last time. Rangina, I'm pleased you're here.
We are little Christ.
We are little Christ. Yes, we looked at the word Christian and we saw that that was just a word that means little Christ. So we are, if you like, little models of Christ. Yes, very good. Some things about the gospel we looked at last time in this context of us leading up to this outreach we've got in a few weeks' time. More of that in a few minutes. But what were some of the key things we saw about the gospel last time? How the gospel is communicated? And Steve went over again some of this with you last week. What were some of the key things about the gospel being communicated? Yeah.
Conviction.
Yes, with conviction. That was one of it. There were four things about the gospel, the way the gospel comes. And one of them is about the deep conviction in our hearts as we share the gospel with other people. Yeah, very good.
Words of God.
Yes, words. That's the second thing. So it's words. The third thing was power. That it's not just... Let me keep up with you, Ismat. So there is God's word, but it's not just words, it's power, which was the title last time. Not just words, but power. Deep conviction and...
Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit at work. And that all those components about the gospel coming. And there was something else. I made a comment. It doesn't say this in 1 Thessalonians... that Greenford Baptist Church should be known for, but I said that coming out of this passage last time, there's something that we should be known for in our local community. Do you remember what it was? Say again?
That God's work should result in action.
Yeah, that's one of the things we saw. Faith, that was very good. Faith results in things that can be seen. Faith results in things that can be seen, results in action that can be seen. That's very good. What was the other thing about us as a church we looked at last time? I gave you some examples of it as well. We should be known for serving God. We should have a reputation in the community for serving God in the different things that we do. That we should be known for making a difference in our community. Okay, well done. So we come today to chapter 2. We're not doing the whole chapter. We're looking at just the first 12 verses today. And if you're still looking for it, it's page 1186. If you've got one of our church Bibles, it's on page 1186. You know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. At Philippi, Paul had had a really hard time. We haven't read it, but the account is there in Acts if you want to read it later. Paul, part of his hard time is he'd been stripped naked publicly. He'd been flogged in the public square. He'd then been put in prison, chained, been put in the stocks. And he'd had a very, very hard time. And you can understand, having just left Philippi, his next stop was Thessalonica, if he kept the low profile. If he decided to just keep his head down and just to be quiet. You could have understood that, couldn't you? Reasonable thing to do. Not a right thing to do, but a reasonable thing to do. But in fact, he didn't do that. Instead, he fearlessly and boldly proclaim the gospel. How did he do that? He tells us he did that with the help of our God. We dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. Now, some of our church family, and you've heard people giving testimonies from the front, in the context of the cultures that they come from, they have experienced strong opposition, even persecution, for telling others about Jesus. Remember, we had Yosef came and told us some of his story, and that he was threatened with death And he talked about how in his country that he comes from, how there are thousands of Christians who are being kept. Prisons are a bit of a nice word for what they're doing. They're actually storing them in shipping, you know, those big shipping containers? They're actually storing the Christians in those containers outside. So it's burning hot during the day, freezing cold at night. He talked about people being killed. It's an extreme Marxist regime. He talked about that. So we have people among us who have suffered because they've been faithful in telling the gospel. But most of us here, particularly those of us that you know, grown up in the UK, grown up in even the London area, we don't know what it means to suffer for telling other people the good news about Jesus. But as we prepare here that in just a few weeks' time we're going to be proclaiming the gospel in our own community, we're aiming to visit 2,000 houses in the couple of weeks running up to Easter, offering to pray for people, inviting people to the events that we're holding. We're holding a big event here on Easter Bank Holiday Monday, inviting the community to come along here and spend some or all of the day with us. As we prepare for that, and it's something that all of us are going to be involved in, as we prepare for that, what can we learn from Paul's testimony here? What can we take from Paul's testimony, his experience? What can we learn from that? Because our God is the same, amen?
Amen?
And human beings haven't changed a lot, have they? So what do we take from Paul's situation that affects us and how we are going to see what we're going to do in the coming month and beyond? Fiona?
Making an attempt doesn't mean you're going to fail. It's positive, even if it goes doesn't appear to be any positive result. The fact that you've tried is positive and God's going to be really happy.
Okay, so the first thing...
We're not going to fail.
The first thing, we're doing it in God's strength, we're not going to fail. We have to step out and trust God. Yep. What else? Yeah. Hannah.
Not even when we're around, some people don't want to listen. We shouldn't be discouraged. We should just carry on doing what God has asked us to do.
Okay, even when we are talking to people and people say, oh, you know, you are mad, I don't want to listen to you, we mustn't be discouraged by that, but keep going, absolutely, because we've got good news to tell. And we've got good news to tell, you know, because we know what God has done in our lives, amen? We see, so we're going out to tell good news to people. So what else can we learn? Rangina?
Go because God's Spirit is within us.
Okay, so we go trusting in God's Spirit, but also knowing what it is that we believe. It's about that deep conviction we looked at last time. Yep, very good. What else, Elizabeth?
We should know as we go out, we have the help of God. We're not going alone.
That is so important. As we go out, we don't go by ourselves in any sense of that. We go with God's help. We go with God's help. And, you know, I know some of you have never been door-to-door telling people about Jesus and offering to pray for people before. There'll be some of you. How many people have ever done that? Have been going door-to-door telling other people about Jesus, offering to pray for people? Okay, that's probably about half of the people here, which means half of you have never done it before. And I imagine that for some of you that have never done it before, this idea, you're a bit nervous. What Elizabeth said is so true. We go out with the help of our God. So we see Paul here, who last time had been publicly humiliated, stripped, flogged, thrown in prison, and yet he still dared to tell people the good news because the news is so good. We want to tell people about it. Anything else we can take from this testimony? Is Matt?
I was touched last Wednesday when we came here for the healing night. And a message from the speaker when he said, we are carrying answers with us.
Yeah,
it's not the good news. We have always answers. We're carrying answers, so we need to pass these answers to the people.
Yeah.
So it's not only the good news. We want to see people and give them some answers.
Yeah. Yes, we've got answers to give to people. And people are looking forward to us coming. Steve was out yesterday doing some survey work, getting ready, and he chatted to a family. And they said, when you come and pray, make sure you come to our house and come and pray for us. And they gave Steve his address. Say, make sure, we really want this. So So we go with God's help. We go with God already at work in our community. And we go without fear, knowing that we trust God. I'm really excited about this outreach. And I'm really excited. We already have, I think it's over 70. How many have we got, Richard, signed up for doing the door-to-door so far? It's 70. So we need another 30 people, because our target is to have 100 people, 50 pairs of people, going out telling other people about Jesus. So, Richard, can you stand up? If you've not signed up yet for doing the door-to-door, you've not filled a form in yet, see Richard afterwards. Richard, Steve's not here today. Steve's running a half marathon this morning, so that's why he's not here. So see Richard after. He will help you fill the form out and so on. And we're looking for another 30 people. So we have 100 people, 50 pairs, each pair going to 40 houses. That means we visit 2,000 homes. But that will only happen if we're all involved. And we can go with God's help, confident in God, being inspired by Paul's testimony here. Let's go on, verse 3. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. I want to pick up that phrase. I'll come back to some of the other parts in a moment. But that phrase, entrusted with the gospel. You see, because that was true of Paul, but it's true of me. And of Frank. And of Carol. I could go round. It's true of all of us here who've invited Jesus into our lives. We've been entrusted with the gospel. God has given you the good news to look after. Amen?
Amen.
Is it for your benefit?
No.
Is it for your benefit?
No.
No's the right answer. We've received the good news, but the gospel we've been entrusted with in this sense is it's not for our benefit. We are stewards. Paul doesn't use the word steward here, but the concept is there. We are stewards. God has given us something of incredible value. Fantastic value. And God's given it to all of us. Not just for us, but actually for us to give away, to give to other people. You know, let's use this illustration. If you had a wonderful benefactor, okay, someone who was really rich, and he gave you £1,000 and said, this is for you. You thought, oh, that's good news. Now, he said, every one of your friends that you tell about me and get in contact with me, I will give them £1,000. You would be on the phone, wouldn't you? Hey? You'd be on the mobile, sending text messages. You'd be, wouldn't you? I mean, you wouldn't stop. Is that fair? I tell you, what God has given you is worth an awful lot more than £1,000. It's eternal life. It's transformation. And it is the answer to people's needs around us. God has given you something so much more valuable than just a mere £1,000. What's £1,000? It's of no eternal value. Can't take it with you when you die. I mean, what, you know? But what God has given us is of eternal value. Lasts forever. Eternal life. God's presence in our lives transforming. And he wants to do that for everybody around us. And you have been entrusted with it. Amen? So we need to be seizing the opportunities of this season as we come up to this Easter season. We need to be seizing these opportunities, telling people about Jesus, not just in the door-to-door, not just in the special events, but actually our friends, our neighbours, our family members, the people we meet at the school gate, people we meet wherever. You heard some of the stories here on Wednesday evening that Kristen was telling, the different contexts and places, checkout assistant. Wherever, just telling people about Jesus. Because God's given us something so fantastic, such amazing good news. We need to be telling it all over the place. Because we have been entrusted with the gospel. And God has given us this gospel to share with other people. And the thing that drove Paul to do that was that he wanted to please God. We're not trying to please men, but God who tests our hearts. I came across this quote this week from John Stott, writing on this passage. And he uses a few big words, so this might, for a few of you, might just, if it doesn't make sense to you, just let it go. But he said, I like this, I caught hold of this. He said, to be accountable to God, so, you know, for God to be our judge, is to be delivered from the tyranny of human criticism. To be accountable to God is to be delivered from the tyranny of human criticism. So it doesn't matter when we go and speak to somebody to pick up Hannah's copy. It doesn't matter when we go and talk to somebody and they say, oh, I don't want to know. You people are mad. You're nutters. You'll actually find very few people on the doors that actually response from. Maybe you might find one among your 40 houses. You may find none at all. But it doesn't matter, because actually we're doing this for an audience of the King. Audience of one. We're serving God. He's given us something to give away, and he's watching to see what we do with it. To see us giving it away all around us to loads and loads of people. Paul had been entrusted with it. We've been entrusted with it. Let's follow the passage through. You know, we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We're not looking for praise from men, nor from you or anyone else. Now, you've got this series of statements that Paul makes here. He denies that he's got impure motives. He denies that he used flattery. He denies that he put on a mask to cover up greed. And there is a big disagreement among people that interpret the Bible, the people that do it for a living, the professional theologians, about what is going on here with Paul. And there are two possibilities, basically. On the one hand, you've got some who argue that Paul was defending himself against criticism. You know, Paul had had to leave Thessalonica very suddenly. And maybe some of those that were opposed to him were saying, well, you see what he's like. He's a charlatan. He was only in it for what he could get out of it. The moment things got difficult, he naffed off. You know, he was just trying to use words to impress you. And all of that stuff, he was saying it was just a mask for greed, trying to line his own pocket. So some argue that what's happening here is that Paul has been received these criticisms, and so Paul is defending himself against those criticisms. And that's a possible understanding of the passage here. Others point out, and I'm actually in the other camp, so that is a possible understanding, but I actually think there's a better way of understanding this passage. When you read the rest of 1 Thessalonians, which you're going to do this week, when you have a nice cup of coffee, cup of cocoa, you're going to sit and read Thessalonians all the way through from end to end. Yeah, amen? Amen. I'll ask you in a few weeks' time if you've done it. Okay, we'll have a show of hands. Is that fair? Yes. You know, where the teacher sets your homework, ask if you've done it. So in a few weeks' time, I will ask you the question. But when you make your cup of whatever and you sit and read Thessalonians all the way through from end to end, you will find that nowhere else in this letter is Paul defending himself. So that obviously isn't the main thing that he's writing about. The second thing that you won't see in Thessalonians, but if you read other letters from the time written by non-Christians, other teachers, writers, and philosophers, you will find that in their writings, a passage like this is normal. It was a part of the standard things that, you know, like when we write letters, you know, we begin, there's a set format, you know, you're writing to somebody, you know, dear so-and-so, hope you are well, thank you for, you know, if you're writing a thank you letter, thank you for the, I have used it for, I hope to see you soon, your, you know, it's a standard format, standard things that go in letters. Now, if you've got one of those, a Microsoft Word, and you use that letter template thing, it fills all the bits in for you. And you have to put the names in, it writes the thing for you. You know, standard letter format. It's wonderful, apparently. I've never worked out how to use it, but it's apparently wonderful. And so there are standard things that go in letters. And so this sort of thing is the standard stuff that was in the letters of the time. And so it is quite possible that Paul is just following in the way that he does, in the way he begins the letter, and the way he works through the letter, and the ending of the letter, that he's following just a standard way of doing things, so that it's just a routine comment that we didn't ought to read an awful lot into. Which of those views you take actually doesn't matter hugely. The key thing is this. The vital fact to grasp, as I was saying just now, and Paul says it against here, it is only what God makes of us and our motives that really counts. One writer I read this week, another writer, I call Beale, our only motive in doing anything as a Christian should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Our only motive for doing anything as a Christian should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Any other motive will lead us into sinful behaviour. I want us to think about that for a few minutes. What other motives do you think sometimes for people like us in the context that we find ourselves in? What other motives might come to the surface that might guide us or drive us wrongly in the things that we do, even the things that we do in church, even the things that we might do for God? What are some of the wrong motives that might be in the lives of Christians like us? Leslie?
To impress other church members that you're doing all the Christian ways, you know, offering your services, but just to, so that the whole community thinks that you're doing it.
Okay, so it's about your own position, so people think well of you, you know. So you get a nice big Bible that looks well thumbed, and you bring it along, let everybody see it, so they know that you read your Bible. And so you do stuff so that other people think well of you and think, Leslie, she's a really on-fire Christian. She's wonderful. Yeah. If you want to read some of Leslie's testimony, by the way, on the wall, halfway down the hall there, is some of Leslie's testimony published in a national newspaper last week. And there's a whole part of Leslie's life that you know nothing about, most of you here. And there's some great pictures of her there as well, with a number of famous people. So, but thank you for that. You might want to look at that later. Okay, so people think well of us. Other wrong motives?
To earn God's love. To earn God's love.
Very good. So we might think that we need to earn God's love. That somehow we've got to demonstrate to God that we're worthy. And the fact is, we never can be worthy. We never, ever can earn it. But we might feel that we want to demonstrate, to show God how good we are. Okay, yeah, very good. What other wrong motives? Liz?
Kind of what you said before, but kind of not doing things for fear of upsetting people.
Okay, so being prevented from doing things by fear. So being driven by fear that we might upset someone. Now, when we sit and tell our friend that actually, you know, they're not going to spend eternity with God if they continue living the way they're living, they might be offended by that.
Yeah.
Is that the sort of thing you're talking about?
Yeah, or even within church.
Okay.
To say something you think might cause offence.
Okay, not wanting to speak the truth because it might upset somebody. Yeah? Yeah. And that's a particular temptation for church leaders. Thinking, actually, well, I won't say that because it might upset, and that isn't for the best of the other person. I saw a hand, I didn't notice whose it was. Yes, Mark?
For selfish reasons, selfish motives.
Selfish motives, such as?
Such as people try to do things for themselves rather than thinking, giving freely. It says in the Bible, well.
Okay, so people trying to line their own spiritual pockets, is that what you mean?
Yes, spiritual credit in the bank.
Okay, yeah, trying to earn spiritual credit. So they're actually doing it primarily to benefit themselves.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. What other wrong motives might be around? People like us. Yes, lady.
Acceptance from men and to become famous.
To become famous, yeah, to get acceptance from other people. If I do this, if I go up to Richard and fill in one of his forms and volunteer to do door-to-door, Richard's going to think nice things of me. So, you know. Is Matt?
To condemn others.
To
condemn others.
To condemn others. Could you explain that? I know what you mean. A couple of sentences more.
Yeah, rather than to pass the good news to others, to condemn what they are doing.
Okay.
Or use the message to condemn others.
You like to push ourselves up and push other people down and say...
Showing we are right and they are wrong.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Not both of us, we need for God for the forgiveness.
Very good, very good. Yeah, okay. Ah, oh, I see a hand over there. Yeah, Denisa.
To hide, you know, who we truly are. You know, you could be doing other things that are really wicked, but you're just trying to put a front.
So it's putting a front on, putting a mask on. So the other parts of our lives could actually be evil.
Yeah,
but we try and put a front on. So. Maybe by coming along to church and saying some nice prayers and singing some nice songs, the people will think we're okay. And it's to conceal, it's a mask that conceals the reality. All of those things are wrong motives. All of those things are wrong motives. But they have this tendency, they have this way that they can creep into our lives if we're not careful. And our only motive, in doing anything as a Christian, should be a heartfelt desire to please God, to do what God wants us to do. Not to earn merit with God, not to earn credit with God. We can't do that. That game is over. You know, none of us are going to make the grade in our own strength. That is just never going to happen. But actually, because God has loved us and God has given us so much, we want to serve him. We want to use our lives to please him. And Paul said this, as apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. You know, Paul could have thrown his weight around. I mean, you know, he was a church leader, evangelist, prophet, apostle. He could have, you know, just thrown his weight around and got people to do stuff for him. But instead, he was gentle. And the NIV uses this phrase, like a mother. Now, the word that's used for mother there is the word that is used for a breastfeeding mother. So the concept here is a nursing mother, a mother who is caring for very little children. And the way that you care for very little children is even more gentle and more self-sacrificial and more caring than when you're caring for children as they grow up a bit. Because when they're very small, Rachel's little daughter, very small, everything has got to be done for her. Is that right? Managed to do anything herself yet? Everything's got to be done. And there is a whole self-sacrificial thing. I mean, can I use you as an illustration for a moment, Rachel? I'm not going to ask any questions, but just you know, Rachel's life for the last week and 2 days has revolved around Hadassah. Have I pronounced that correctly? Yeah. Has revolved around Hadassah. 24 hours a day? Haven't had any time off yet? All the time, her life has revolved around the care for her daughter. And that is the image that is used here of Paul caring for the church. It's one of two images, and the two are quite different. This is the first of those images. And it is this caring for. This is about self-sacrificial care, a care that reflects God's nature. Now, we think a lot about God as Father, but actually, also in Scripture, God is spoken of as mother. And God is spoken of as a mother caring for her small children. That image is used of God as well. You know, mothers are equally in the image of God to fathers. And we often, in the way we pray the Lord's Prayer, our Father in Heaven, we lose sight of the reality of God's motherhood, which is a clear stream that is there throughout Scripture. Some of you will know that I was in Cambodia last autumn. And on a particular day, we went to all the way over Cambodia, there are killing fields, where the Pol Pot regime killed people from the community. The biggest of them is in Phnom Penh, where I forget the number, just huge, huge numbers of people were killed. But every village had its own killing field, where the people from the regime would actually take out the people in the local community they felt weren't fit to live and would kill them. And their bodies were just thrown into the field. And in many of those areas, those bodies have now been dug up, or the bones, and they're in the centre of a square, and they're in a large, like a perspex tower, that's just filled with human bones. And people come there and pray. And this particular place had a prayer place next to that. And the guide who was with us on the day we went to this place, he said, before we go and walk round, he said, I just want to tell you a bit about my own life. And he had been a child during the time of the Pol Pot regime. And his father had been killed by the regime. His mother was left looking after him and his brother. And he said, my mother died. My mother died because all the food that she was able to get, she gave to me and my brother. She said, I didn't understand it until later. But she starved to death so that I might live. She gave her life for me. And, the whole emotion of the place was just enormous, but as he talked about that. And that's what Paul is talking about here. The self-sacrificial care. And of course, God has done that for us in that Jesus came into our world to lay down his life so that we might live. That's the heart of the good news, of the gospel that we have to share. Such is the depth of God's love for us. And Paul says this is the same sort of love that we should have for other people. So let's think about ourselves. We're unlikely to be in the extreme situation that I related from the story in Cambodia. But let's think about ourselves for a moment, for us here, particularly those of you here who would consider yourself to be mature Christians, those who've been walking with God for some time. What does it mean for you today? For you to be like a mother to young Christians, or even in this context here, as we're reaching out to non-Christians, to be like a mother, how does that image apply to us? What does it mean for us in practical terms? It's a great picture, very emotional picture, but we need to root it into what it means, next Tuesday. What does it mean for us for that? Susan?
For me, as a mature Christian and to a young Christian and even just day life, is the way I live my life is to be an example to the young Christian, that they may see Christ in me.
Okay, so it's about being an example.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. What else? Marion?
Showing love.
Showing love. How? What sort of ways might we show love? It's one or two.
Well, if we were talking about God and saying how much he loved us and what he did for us, that sometimes we have to make a sacrifice for them as well, but in a different way.
Okay, so it's about us making a sacrifice of ourselves. Yeah, Belinda.
Turn the other cheek over and over and over again and just show that you care for living when...
What does turn the other cheek mean in everyday language, Belinda, if you don't mind?
When people have done things wrong to you, rather than retaliate or pay them back, you turn the other cheek, as it says.
Okay, so it's about not retaliating.
And then when they need your help, but whenever you can give your help, you still do so.
Okay, so even when we have a small child and that child treats us as a mother badly, we don't treat the child badly. We actually go on caring for the child and just allow that to pass by. Yeah, okay, Linda.
To teach right and wrong. With a child, it can take a while. They have to learn what they're doing is right or what they're doing is wrong. And you encourage them when you do the right, and you discourage them, but you do it lovingly.
Okay.
So with a Christian, a young Christian, there will be things that they might be doing that are wrong, that they need to be shown that is wrong, but you show it lovingly, like a mother, like you would do. And if they're doing things right, you encourage them.
Okay, so right, encouraging right and wrong. Rachel, Adassa, has she got to the point where, you know, there are sort of, you know, there are fixed times when, you know, you have some rest time, and there is this time when she's going to ask for things, and or does she do things at sort of inconvenient moments, like 1:30 in the morning and 3:30 in the morning and 2:30 in between as well? So there's something about being a mother in this context. Actually, it's about putting up with inconvenience and awkward times, and that make demands on us as well.
Yeah, and also because, as mother now of four, they demand things at the same times. And so it's about still being able to give and meet their needs somehow within that. So, you know, if you're caring for... I mean, if we're looking at, like, young Christians, there's not necessarily just one in your life. There could be a number that God's asking you to care for.
Yeah.
And finding God's strength to balance that and their different needs at the same time.
So caring for a number of different people, balancing that, and that's at cost to us. Joan?
An aspect of that is making sure that the young Christians are fed.
Mm. That they do. Very good image, yes. Making sure young Christians are fed. They grow. Yeah, Christine.
Now I see if there's someone that's not even a Christian yet that you're praying for, you continue to pray, don't give up until, you know, something comes on.
Okay, so we've got someone around us that we're praying for is not a Christian yet. We just go on and on praying for them. We don't give up. So it's about that self-sacrificial thing. Oh, I'm surrounded by hands suddenly. Okay. Make these the last three here. We'll go 1, 2, 3. So, yeah, Liz.
Just thinking about parenthood, when your child asks you the same question for about the 18th time, and you think, yeah, I've explained that to you, and you're okay, but they need that reassurance.
Okay, so it is being put up with being asked the same question over and over. And
being able to invest wholeheartedly for the 18th or 19th.
Yeah, so continue to invest in them. Very good. Fiona?
Optimising preparation time. If you're planning to have a child, you have that time to prepare. So you bought the nappies, you bought the bottles, and you've done that. So there's practical preparation you can do just before it happens so that you're ready for the 1:00 in the morning wake-up call.
Okay.
You've got the time. You're not completely caught and prepared.
All right. So this being a mother to people, it is also about preparing for that and planning for that and so on. Very good. Elizabeth?
We need to have the patient, because sometimes there are sometimes when somebody, young Christian, when they mess up, and if you're angry, you will start rebuking them.
Yeah.
You won't be able to carry their burden.
Okay, so we have to be patient. I mean, when we're looking after small children, yeah, there is patience there. So even when they mess up, yeah, we go on. Yeah. We don't start rebuking them and shouting at them and so on. So, very good. Very good. It's a very powerful image, isn't it? And this is an image of how God, remember where this comes from, it's an image of how God cares for us. And it's because this is how God cares for us. So all this stuff that we've been talking about, and more besides, is a part of how God cares for us, and therefore we ought to care for others. It's important we see that actually we receive this from God, and we give it to others because we should be reflecting God's nature and God's character. So there is that two-stage there. Let's go on to the last... we'll just look at verse 9. Surely you remember, brothers, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel to you. This is just a reference to the fact that Paul... we know from elsewhere that Paul had the right to expect financial support from the Thessalonians. He was receiving gifts from other churches at the time, we know that. He had the right to receive financial support from them, but he chose not to do that. In fact, we know that Paul worked as a tent maker. He made tents. He was a leather worker and made tents. And that was how he earned his living. So that rather than just taking from the Thessalonians, he wanted to give them at no cost to them at all. So he had financial support from elsewhere, but while he was in Thessalonica, he also aimed to work as a leather worker, a tent maker, so that he could actually not take anything from them financially. And then he went on, verse 10, "You are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into his kingdom and glory." So here is the other image. There is the image of Paul being a mother, but also image of Paul being a father. A father who was working among them to see them living lives that were worthy of God. Now, in Paul's day, it's not quite so true, certainly in our culture here, so much. There was a very clear line between the role of fathers and the role of mothers. In Paul's day, there was a big divide between how that worked. So the mother was responsible for the child's practical needs and care, and the father was responsible for developing how the child lived its life, how the child grew up and developed and achieved its potential. And Paul, in the spiritual realm, did both of those for the Thessalonians. So, and again, God was his heavenly father and treated him in a particular way, and so he lived that out as how he treated other people. You see the same pattern. It's about being in God's image. God is our father. God treats us in a particular way. We reflect that character and nature in how we treat other people. Same principle there as well. And the whole drive for him was encouraging, comforting, and urging for the Thessalonians to be living lives that were worthy of God. Let's just take a couple of minutes to think about that phrase. If Paul was working among us here in this church community, this church family here, and was working among us to see us living lives that were worthy of God, what would be the things that he'd be looking to see in our lives? So if Paul was here working as a part of Greenford Baptist Church here in West London and was working among the church here, what would be the things as he looked at our individual and our corporate church life, what would be the things that he would be looking for to see us as we live here in West London in 2009 that are lives that are worthy of God? What would be the key things, do you think? Joan?
One of the basic things would be that we don't, as he put it somewhere else, forsake assembling ourselves together, that we meet regularly and that people don't call themselves part of the...
Okay, so this is the phrase in Hebrews we had read for us this morning. It is about actually meeting together and assembling together.
It wasn't Paul then.
Well, there's a debate about whether Paul wrote Hebrews. We won't go there. Right to the very back, Sarah. Just wait a moment, let me get all the way here first.
To become mature for the Lord.
Become mature for the Lord, yeah.
Not like our Christianity is not like up and down.
Ah.
Depend on situations.
So there's a stability in God. We don't go up and down with the weather or what's in the post or how we're feeling today. There is a stability tossed around like corks on the sea, I think James talks about it. We actually are stable in God. So living lives worthy, recognising that God doesn't change, he's the same, and so we should be stable and constant with God. Yeah, very good, thank you.
That we should be doing unto others as we would have them unto ourselves.
Okay, so we should be treating other people. I don't think as we'd want them to treat us. I think, Mark, it's better we'd be treating other people as God has treated us.
Yes.
I think that's a better image. Mm-hmm. I understand what you're saying, but we should be treating other people. Paul would be looking to see that Mark is treating people around him in the way that God has treated Mark. Yes. Okay with that?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes?
I encourage each other and pray for each other by praying.
So he'd be looking to make sure we're in our meeting together groups. You know, hope you're all doing that, meeting together with two or three other people at least once a fortnight to pray together, to read scripture. So we're meeting together, we're praying for each other, we're encouraging each other. So that would be a part of living lives worthy. Yeah, Fiona.
Exhibiting the fruits and the gifts of the Spirit together.
Whoa, fruits and gifts of the Spirit.
All of them together at various, whatever level we're at, each is at a different level of that. But within the whole church, seeing that everything's being represented.
Okay, so the if you like, the fruit of the Spirit are the characteristics of God.
Yeah.
Love, joy, peace, gentleness, and all of that. So seeing those lived out. And the gifts of the Spirit, God's enabling for us, seeing those things used as well, not being hidden away. Yeah, very good. What else? Living lives worthy of God. One or two final comments. Yes?
We'll also be encouraging us to go out and tell people about what God is doing now.
Yeah, he'd be looking to see living lives worthy of God, that we're telling other people about Jesus. I think that would be something he'd be looking for in the context of this Thessalonians. That would be one of the top of his list. We're living lives worthy of God by telling other people about Jesus. Yeah, last two. Belinda.
He'll be looking to see that we're a family, not only on Sundays, but all through the week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not about how we are on a Sunday between 10 o'clock and 12 or 12:40 today, but actually it's how we are from the rest of the week, how we're living our lives together, corporately. Yeah, Carol, finally.
To nurture whatever gifts that your children have, but also, you know, to be prepared as, say, spiritual parents, not only in the family sense, but of younger Christians. I think of Frank, like Frank taught Joshua to play the guitar when he was four, but like he's
a bit better than his dad,
yeah,
isn't he?
Exactly.
To put it mildly.
Yeah. So, you know, make room for that as well.
That's a really important thing, actually, because sometimes when you know, living life worthy, it's actually about enabling people to be better than us. Allowing people to be better than us. And it doesn't matter that Josh is actually a far better guitar player than Frank is ever going to be.
Bask in the reflected glory, of course.
So Frank can bask in the reflected glory. But it came about because Frank used his gift to give that away to enable Josh to actually grow up and do all the stuff that he does so well. And so that's very important. Okay, let's... our time is nearly gone. We've just got a few minutes left. So let's think back over the 12 verses we've looked at this morning. What are the main things that we're going to take away from today that actually is going to affect the way that we live in the next week, the next month, and beyond that? What are the main things, the big things that we take away from these 12 verses this morning? What are the key things that we've learned this morning? Anita.
Unconditional love and putting God first, whatever the cost, like Paul did and what he went through, and our love for others and caring. As Christ laid down his life for us, we should be prepared to do whatever the cost is to do what he calls us.
Unconditional love and serving God, whatever the cost. Yes, very good. Did I see your hand? Yep. Yes.
We've been entrusted for the gospel, so we should test our motives. We should have the right motives to serve people.
So our motives need to be pleasing God. Any other motive is not good. Not good. It's wrong. It's sinful. Yeah. Anything else? Other main things from this morning? Lorraine.
I would say living our lives in a way that will bring glory to God.
Living our lives in a way that we should be living our lives in a way that bring honour and glory to God. So people look at you and actually they want to, they think God is good all the time. What else? Anything else? Fiona.
We're not doing it for ourselves, we're doing it to show God that we love him.
Yeah, we're not doing it for ourselves, we're doing it to show God that we love him. There were three things for me that stood out as I looked at this week. As we draw on God's strength, we should boldly, fearlessly be telling others about Jesus, proclaiming the gospel. Second thing is what God makes of us and our motives that really matters. Connected with that, this quote I read earlier on, our only motive in doing anything as a Christian should be a heartfelt desire to please God. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish this morning. As always, a moment or two for you to make your own response to God, anything you want to say to God. And then in a minute or two, I will pray for us together as we finish this morning. Father God, I want to thank you for the amazing gospel, good news that we have been privileged here, most of us in the room here at this point in time. We have been privileged to accept and receive. Father God, thank you for that amazing good news, that amazing gift of forgiveness, that amazing gift of your Holy Spirit in our lives, that amazing gift of life that begins now and will run for the whole of eternity. Father God, thank you. Thank you for all that you have given us. Father, help us this week and in these coming weeks to be boldly and fearlessly sharing the wonderful gift that you've given us with people around us. With our friends and neighbours, people that we don't know, people that we meet in different contexts and places, telling them the good news that, Father God, you love them, you care for them, and you've got so much that you want to give them. Father God, I ask this morning for your Spirit to be upon us individually and corporately, that you will anoint us and enable us and empower us through your Spirit this week, to be living lives that are worthy of you in everything that we do, in everything that we say, in every context and place that we find ourselves, that we are living lives worthy of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034. And our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.